You don't want your face to show up. Make sure your camera's off. Okay. So, having discussed reader's purpose, why you are reading it, you are aware that the tools I'm going to give you today have very, very specific jobs, and not every tool is going to be needed in every reading, correct? I'm going to give you a bunch of tools, and then it's going to be up to you to decide when and where it is appropriate to use them. That's a big responsibility. I have friends who use chainsaw a lot. My dad's a chainsaw carver, my brother's a chainsaw carver. I cut wood almost every weekend because it's how I heat my house. I have friends that are terrified of a chainsaw. And I always make a joke like, well, yeah, it's a dangerous tool, but you sure know which end not to touch, right? Like, it's the end with a spinny chain of death. Like, don't touch that part and you're probably gonna be fine. Every tool that is a powerful tool that does a big job comes with risks. You don't jump on a bulldozer and not know how to operate a bulldozer. Because if things go wrong with big, powerful tools, they go wrong in big, powerful ways. Chainsaws, dynamite, bulldozers, if you know how to use them, are fantastically useful and they take an extremely difficult job and they turn it into a 3-second job. If you don't know how to use that tool, you might die. Literally, with those tools. With the tools I'm giving you, you're not gonna die, but you have to use the tools carefully because I'm assuming it's everyone's goal to go to seventh grade next year and not do a victory lap around sixth grade. Just kidding, it's not necessarily victory. Like, we don't want to do this twice. We want to get it right the first time. So you have to use your judgment. You have to be careful on how to use these tools. So when we're talking features of nonfiction text, I'm going to give you the exact situation in which we're going to use them. Because remember, we're talking about nonfiction text that you can just pick up and read. But we're focusing more on how to use these tools to be a successful student because that's what we need right now. Because we know there are those of us out there that are intelligent people that are not experiencing the level of success that we want to, and clearly we want to. So I'm going to focus more on school-related explanation rather than pick up a nonfiction book and read it explanation. Making sense? Cool. The tools that we use, you've seen them before. You probably haven't used them that much. Some of these tools are really more relevant in a book and not particularly relevant on a website. I'm going to do my best to explain how you would use both. And some of these tools you won't find on a website because websites do it for you rather than give you any kind of expectation that you have to turn to the back of the book. Like, some of these tools just don't fit for a website. Nonfiction text features take the place of the plot, saying, and characters, the very few tools that we would use when we're reading fiction. They're just much more specific. First one, title page. This is easy. It comes before everything else, and it gives credit where credit is due. A title page shows you the title, the author and/or the illustrator, the publishing company, the copyright date, the editors, and frequently some other stuff like which company published it. Oh yeah, that's already up there. Which company published it? Like, did they give more than one version? Like, it gives the ISBN numbers for the Library of Congress. A lot of information that you're probably not going to use, but some information you are 100% definitely going to use, and it's super easy to find because it's right in front of everything else. Usually it's right in front of the table of contents even. Like, it's the first thing you're going to see. I have an example of a nonfiction book here. If I open it up to the first page, boom, title page. A lot of times has an illustration on it, even if the rest of the book doesn't have an illustration, just because like that's not a lot of stuff to include on one whole page, right? So a lot of times they'll fill it with an illustration. Here's where relevant information comes in, and you guys already brought this up. You're the first one in my box to bring it up. Relevant information is recent. You guys are currently researching stressors on teens and preteens. Teens, not preteens, right? Stressors on, and you guys are basically teens. You're within a 6 months to a year being a teen anyway. Stressors on teens in 1996 when I was a teen versus 2018, 19, or 20 are going to be very different stressors, correct? Nobody had a cell phone in their, well, not nobody, very few people had a cell phone in their pocket when I was a teen. Maybe a pager. I don't even know if you guys know what that is. Nope. No reason you should. That's old tech where they would just say, hey, you need to call this number, and you go to a payphone and call the number. Probably don't even know what a payphone is because
My dad actually took a picture with one when we went to
antiques. the information, if you found a web page from 1996, which there do exist in the dinosaur ages of the internet, on teen stressors would not be relevant anymore. You could have some useful facts in it, but those facts, we're not necessarily going to trust them. If you find a web page with that's research-based from 2018, it's going to be very relevant. That was only 2 years ago. So that's about as fast as you can study information, put numbers on it, and get it onto the internet and have it be reliable. Stressors on teens are going to change. I mean, you guys are experiencing that right now. Stressors on teens right now are much, much different than they were last year at this time. When school shut down last March, stressors changed a lot. Stressors on you have changed. You missed a very big part of fifth grade. That means teens missed very big parts of their high school years. My niece was a senior. She missed the last part of her senior year. She missed her senior prom. Her graduation wasn't the same. Students, teens right now are doing class surrounded in plastic, wearing masks, and have to put up with cleaning. They have to come to school and be socially distant, which teens don't do. Some teens are choosing to do virtual school. Talked to my nephew last night. One of his biggest stressors right now is he's a basketball kid. He's been to the Channing Tatum camps. He's 6'3" and 14 years old, and he's a good player. He decided, because he lives next door to my parents, who are both senior citizens, that he would do virtual school and not play basketball this year because he didn't want a chance bringing coronavirus home to them. And he said, I know teens, we're not going to socially distance at school. We're just not. And I was like, I don't want to hear that because I'm a teacher, and yet I know what I say 400,000 times a day. Yeah, that's probably right. He said, and I can't take a chance on playing basketball, even though I love it, because the first time somebody's this close to my face breathing on me, I'm going to wonder every time if they have corona, and I'm not going to be paying attention to whether or not the rebound's coming my way. That's a heck of a stressor to put on a teenager. So relevant information has a lot to do with date. Why do I bring this up when I'm looking at title page? Because the copyright date is a thing. Copyright date means the date that the copy was registered to the rights of the copy were authored to the register. That means I presented this to the copyright office and said, I wrote this, please give me credit. And they made a registration and said, on December 10th, 2020, Jeremy Gagnon registered with us that this was original text that he wrote. Whether it's internet, whether it's magazine, whether it's book, doesn't matter. Now everyone in the world is aware that I own this because I wrote it. That means if anybody uses it for research, it's me that they need to credit because I did the work. You can find that on the title page. When it comes to website, please don't be this person. I use the website that doesn't have a copyright date or an author. I can't find it anywhere. Thanks, Cletus. That's because your information is trash information. Your website isn't good. Like, oh, it doesn't have a copyright date or an author. It's kind of like, you know when you get that old math book and somebody wrote all the answers in it? That person was dumb enough to write the answers in their math book, or at least disrespectful or not paying attention enough to write all the answers in their math book. How much are you going to trust those answers? A lot? Probably not. If somebody puts something on the internet, it takes work. You either have to know how to code and program a website yourself, or you have to buy a program that codes for you so that you can type it all in. And I had one for a long time that I ran for my classroom before YouTube was a big and Facebook was a big thing. I ran a website for my classroom. It's a ton of work. So guess whose name and dates were slapped all over that website so I can say, this is mine. If you use it, you have to cite me. My name. It's the first reason my students learned my first name is because I found it on my website because it was at the bottom that says copyright, whatever year it was, property of Jeremy Gagnon. I did the work. I wanted the credit. Could you find a relevant fact on a trash website? Well, let me ask you a question. If you dug through the trash can outside my room yesterday, could you have found a chicken strip? Yeah. Yes, you could have. Did that chicken strip still have trash stank all over it because you dug through and pulled it out of the trash can? Yes, it did. So can you pull a relevant fact off a trash website? Yes, you can. Does it still have trash dank all over it because you found it in a bad spot? Yes, it does. But here's the trick. If you think it might be right, can you confirm that fact on a website that is good? Yes, you can. It's very possible you could pull a chicken strip out of the trash, but you don't want to trust it. You don't want to trust that website, but if you think it might be right, you could totally back check it. But then which one are you going to cite? Are you going to cite this website? Or are you going to cite the website that has actual names and dates on it? Please, somebody actually say names and dates out loud. Yes, you want the one where the author wanted to take credit for it because you know you're going to check that author. My favorite thing on the internet, Mrs. G showed you guys during while you guys were on virtual. The Pacific Northwest Tree Octopus homepage. Oh, I love it so much because it's so stupid, but it looks actually like it might be legit. You guys know what I'm talking about? Not. You shouldn't have been doing your writing when you're virtual. Pacific Northwest Tree Octopus website is clearly ridiculous, and yet it looks really good. I guarantee you there are people out there that looked at that and were like, oh, well, you know, in Washington and Oregon, they have octopus that live in, do you know they have octopus that live in trees? And then their friends are looking at them like they're idiots because they didn't back check their sources. My favorite thing about that website is if you click on the source material, number one, that guy put his name all over the website to make it look legit. Number two, he's got copyright dates on every single picture and piece of information on it to make it look legit. But number three, if you click on any of it, it is clearly fake and he lets you know. But if you don't check on it, I guarantee you there's probably a fourth grader out there somewhere that had to choose an animal to write a three-paragraph report about. It chose the Pacific Northwest tree octopus because probably their uncle was like, hey, Google this Pacific Northwest tree octopus because I would totally have done that to my nephew. And they wrote a paper on it and their teacher is taking pictures of it and texting it to their friends and laughing until they cry because octopi live in the water, not trees. Secret time. Octopi don't live in trees. They need water. It's a thing. You can Google that and they'll put their name on that too. Right? Like, the internet's a crazy place. That was clearly made by some computer programmer who was just bored and messing around or wanted to mess with their kids. My dad would have done that to me. He would have totally programmed a website just to mess with me and then had me write a report on it. I'm like, hey, you should have checked your sources, shouldn't you? Ah! And I would totally have done that to you guys. Like, that would be a blast. And I'd be like, oh, look, I tricked you so that you would learn from it. And we would all laugh a lot. But no matter what, dude, you got to know octopi don't live in trees. No matter how, they don't. Newsflash. No matter how legit that looks, one click tells you it's complete garbage. Don't be the Cletus that's like, well, I use this website and it didn't have any of that. Yeah, I know it doesn't have any of that stuff. It's no good. It's like picking chicken strips out of the trash. If you want to be the person picking chicken strips out of the trash, you have the right to do that, but you're going to throw up from it eventually. And if you'd like to go to seventh grade, please don't pick your information out of the trash. Please pick it from somewhere, because I'm assuming we would all like to go to seventh grade at some point. No victory laps, please. Don't pick your information out of the trash. Pick your information from somebody who says, yeah, I put my name on this because you need to give me credit for it because I did the work and you're using my work. Happily to let you use my work as long as you make sure you know it's mine. I did all my ranting that I already talked about this stuff. Number two, one of the most boring looking but most useful pieces of information you can use in a nonfiction book is a table of contents. And I talk a lot about reader's purpose. You have to know why you are reading. I'm going to use my examples out of a textbook. And a lot of them are going to be social studies because you know that's where I came from. I taught it for a long time. If I assigned you to read a social studies chapter and then answer questions, social studies does have plot setting and characters. It does move in a line. If I assign you to read a social studies chapter, I need you to read that whole chapter. If I assign you to answer questions about that chapter after you read it, do I want you to go back and read the whole thing again? No, that is a ridiculous waste of your time. And a lot of people, I say, do you know that Miss Mosier doesn't want you to read the whole chapter again when you're doing a study guide? And people are like, I kind of don't think she does. But very few teachers have ever said, please don't read this whole thing again. It's a total waste of your time. I am going to say it.
Please don't. Hold on. Please don't read the chapter 400 times to answer every question. It is a total waste of your time. It will drive you completely insane. No one wants an insane student crying into their textbook because that student can't pass a test. Do you hear me, students?
Yeah. Yes, we do.
Excellent. Okay, so.
Someone present? Yep, okay. So what that leaves you with, like, what do I do with that information, right? Don't read it. If Ms. Mosier or Ms. Smith says, I need you to read chapter 3. Yes, they want you to read chapter 3 beginning to end. If Mosier or Smith assigns you some work and says, here's a worksheet, I want you to answer these questions, and you've already read it, that doesn't mean they want you to read it again. It means they want you to be able to find what you're looking for and go right to it. Well, that's what table of contents is. Man, I taught social studies for 10 years. I cannot tell you the number of times I'd be like, turn to chapter 12. And it would be like April. We had been in school August, September, October, November, December, January, February, and then March, and it's April. And I say, turn to chapter 12, and my students would be like, page 1, nope, not there. Page 3, nope, not there. Like, it's going to be 2050 before you graduate sixth grade if you don't look up the numbers. What page is it on? I am not your babysitter. There's a page in the front of our book that literally says page 12 is on page 394. It's right there. It's like the third page of the book. You could totally go flip, oh, this is on 394. And then flip most of the way through the book and get right there. And then, but now the 15, nope, not there. We're two-thirds of the way through the school year. Don't flip through one or two pages at a time. Find where you're supposed to go and go there. It's like, I want to go to Disney World. Let me put my walking shoes on. No, it's a 3 states, 4 states, 5 states from here. We're not putting our walking shoes on. We're getting a plane ticket. We'll get there in an hour. The table of contents is literally there so that you don't have to flip pages, because it is legit. Without knowing what you're looking for or where to find it, you could spend 20 minutes on a study guide flipping pages and just not knowing where you're going. That is a total frustrating waste of your time, and you're not going to be paying attention because you're going to lose track of your thoughts. And if it takes you 3 hours to do a study guide, by the time you're on the second hour, are you doing your best work? Nope. This is the most important slide I'm going to show you ever, because students don't use these resources, and I guarantee it will cut half an hour off of every study guide you do and 10 minutes off of every worksheet you do for the rest of your school careers. Every table of contents has chapters listed, right? Then when you go to that chapter, inside of the chapter, there are headings. So if the chapter is about animal cells in a science textbook, one of the headings is going to be nucleus, contents of the nucleus. Then the next heading is going to be contents outside of the nucleus, right? Two separate pieces of information. Underneath that contents of the nucleus heading, are they going to have one subheading that tells you about each piece? Yes, very, very frequently they will. Headings and subheadings. So you have a chapter that's about animal cells. Then you have a heading that tells you where the piece that they're going to talk about is. Then the subheadings underneath that heading are going to tell you about each individual piece. When I tell you, close your eyes, picture a social studies book. And in between the paragraphs, you see big blue headings and subheadings, right? They're there. You can't see a social studies or science book in your head without seeing those big bold face letters or those big blue letters. I cannot tell you how many times fifth grade, sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, students will just go to the chapter about animal cells and I'll be like, what's a ribosome? They'll start at the first page and just look for the word ribosome over 30 pages. That's a total waste of your time as a student, right? If your goal as a reader is to answer the question, that's the least effective way to do it. What you should do is look at the chapter heading for animal cells, then say, okay, the ribosomes are located in the nucleus. I think that's right. If I'm on YouTube, don't fact check me. I'm just giving examples. Or look up for where the ribosomes are at. And underneath that subheading, it's probably going to say ribosomes and related parts. It's going to guide you in. Remember yesterday when we did outline notes and we started with big ideas, then we chunked them into chunks, then we chunked those chunks into smaller chunks? This is what textbooks do for you. Students have this weird view that we as teachers really just sit around and try to make things as hard as possible. That's not it. We know what we're presenting to you is difficult. Mosier's teaching you 10,000 years of history in 9 months while out on corona leave for half of it and in the hospital for part of it. She's literally in her hospital bed trying to teach you guys 10,000 years of history in 9 months. I know because I said I'd do it for her and she was like, nah, I got this. Smith is trying to teach you guys really advanced scientific concepts. We know that nonfiction learning is difficult. We want you to use these tools to break it down piece by piece and make it easier. But if you're trying to look up what is DNA and you start at the beginning of the chapter and look on every page, 90% of the time you spent was wasted, correct? Headings and subheadings, using them correctly, could literally save you an hour on a remote Monday. Most of the time, what you're doing is looking up information that you've already talked about on a remote Monday, right? What if you're in math? Do they use headings and subheadings in math to break down the steps? I will tell you, I was part of the adoption committee that picked out GoMath, and one of the reasons I picked it out was because the headings and subheadings were so clear, like you could be a blind person and read it, as long as it was Braille. Like the headings and subheadings is like division, step one, step two, step three, step four, divide, multiply, subtract, bring down. Like the headings and subheadings in GoMath are so clear, like they scream at you, hey, pay attention to me. Do we skip them anyway? Yeah, frequently. These are very, very overlooked because we know where our answers are at, right? Our answers in the headings and subheadings. Grace, are you going to find an answer to the question in the heading and subheading? No, you're not. But they're basically a map leading you there. So your brain wants to think, oh, I need to look at the words, not, oh, I need to look at the headings and then the subheadings and then the words, because that seems like a lot more work. But really, remember, when you're reading a heading, it's probably 3 words. Then a subheading's probably 5 words. And then those 5 words are going to tell you whether or not you need to read the 100 words in the paragraph or not. Inserted media. This is the most common thing you will see in any nonfiction book. Tables, chairs, kidding, not chairs. I know that's not a totally not funny dad joke, but I like it anyway, so you have to deal with it. Tables, graphs, charts, text boxes, lists, diagrams, maps, timelines, illustrations, all this stuff. If you're picturing a social studies or a science textbook, there's the headings and subheadings, and then there's the paragraphs, and there's little boxes all over the place, right? These little boxes contain little useful bits of information, or pictures, or a diagram, or charts, or graphs. Here's why. My first year as a social studies teacher, I had a chalkboard, 3 boxes of chalk, a textbook, and that's it. I had the internet in my classroom. It was on my computer and I used it to put in grades. My kids couldn't see it. So if I'm going to teach about Mesopotamia, which my kids have never heard of before, I have to describe everything to them. And you know I love to talk. So I did it. That next year, they put a smart board in my room. And when I taught about Mesopotamia, I started by going to Google Earth and showing them. This is the Fertile Crescent. They call it Fertile Crescent because it's in between the Tigris River and the Euphrates River. And you see how it's green and everything around it is brown? That's because they can grow food there. And my kids were like, bro, cool. It took 15 seconds to explain what Mesopotamia was when I showed them and an entire hour when I was describing it to them. Who do you think learned it better, the 15-second people or the hour people? absolutely the 15-second people, because I literally said, here's the Fertile Crescent, here's a river, here's a river. You see how everything is green in this actual pictures of it from a satellite? It's because there's water there, dude. They can grow food, and everywhere else is a desert. And they're like, eh, yeah, see that? Cool. Crescent shape, too, like a moon. Yeah. When I wanted to explain what a sarcophagus was to my first-year kids, I had to describe every single detail. Sarcophagus come in like 10 layers. Like the mummies, it's like one of those little Russian nesting dolls where you open one up and there's another sarcophagus, and you open it up and there's another sarcophagus, and you're 10 layers deep and you're like, where's the mummy? And the mummy's down in there, but you got to describe a lot of stuff to get there. When I described that, it took forever. And then we made one, and that took forever. And then my next year, I went to the British Museum website, and it's like, hey, that's a sarcophagus. They took it apart. There's the layers. There's a mummy inside. You want to see where they were at? Click, 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 click. All right, here's a virtual tour of King Tut's tomb. But we're going to walk through it right now. Who do you think learned it better? The people that got the description or the people that actually saw it?
People who actually saw it.
What's up, Dawson? Yes.
No, no, how about you?
Good, good. The people who actually saw it learned it better because have you ever heard the idiom, a picture is worth 1,000 words? That means I can show you one picture, I can use 1,000 words to describe it. Which one's faster? Showing the picture. I'll double down on it and I'll say data is worth 1,000 pictures. Because if I can show you a chart that proves my point mathematically and a picture next to it, there's not even a discussion to be had. You're like, yep, there's some facts I can use, and that's the end of it. So why are they sticking all this stuff in little boxes all over the page? Someone must answer.
So you can understand it better?
Yeah. They're just highlighting little useful pieces of information, because if they tried to describe it, they'd have to add 3 more paragraphs. So they're sticking little boxes, little tables, graphs, charts, text boxes, lists, diagrams, maps, timelines, illustrations, pretty much anything extra they stick in a little box on a page, on a textbook or a nonfiction book. Because this Tornadoes book I have, anything extra they put in here, like a picture on every single page, makes you go, oh, yeah, I know exactly what they're talking about. Glossary and keywords. This is the most underrated tool because authors know when they're writing nonfiction that the vocabulary is too high for the reader. If you pick up your science virtual textbook and you're studying cells, you're talking chloroplast, chloroform, photosynthesis, ribosomes, deoxyribonucleic acid. These are all sixth grade vocabulary words for studying plants versus animal cells. They're also at about a 12th grade reading level. Sixth grade word, 12th grade reading level. Doesn't seem to match. Science textbooks know they have to use this vocab. It's the only word for what it is. Sometimes instead of saying deoxyribonucleic acid, they'll say DNA. And then every sixth grade student will go, what's DNA stand for? Deoxyribonucleic acid. What? Yeah, that's why we call it DNA. We know when you're learning about ancient Greece, we're going to have to put Greek words in it. It's literally not even in our language. What reading level is it? It's no reading level. It's not English. It doesn't compute. We can't write about those things without using those very specific vocabulary words, though, can we? No, you can't. So what do you do? What does the textbook do? It does that. It highlights them in yellow, and it puts them in boldface, and it basically screams, hey, 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 pay attention, I'm important. I'm highlighted in yellow, and I'm boldface. If you can see at all, you can notice me, right? Because I'm yellow, and right in the middle of this page of white and black. Please pay attention, I'm an important word. And then not only that, if you go to the back of the book, there's going to be a glossary. And most people are like, why would I use a glossary when it's easier to Google it? And here's why. A glossary is a collection of definitions that they are using in that particular book. So if you look up the definition of chloroplast on the internet, you're going to get everything from first grade definitions to postgraduate doctorate definitions. If you flip to the back of the book and look up the word chloroplast, they're going to give you a four-word definition that shows you exactly what they want you to know, and you can be done with it and move on. Vocabulary is exceptionally important to nonfiction reading because you aren't going to know a lot of it. There's no reason for you to know what photosynthesis is until you study how plants work, correct? You're not going to go out and stand on the playground and be like, well, there's a lot of photosynthesis going on here out today, isn't it? Well, all those plants photosynthesize. No. Nobody, no normal human being is going to do that. I'm probably going to do that today just because it's going to be funny. But no normal human being is going to do that. But to understand how plants work, when you're doing the science chapter, if you don't know what photosynthesis is, you fail. Like, it's day one. So until you get the vocab, you don't get the meaning. But if you Google the vocab, you're going to get 10 hundred, you're going to get an imaginary number of hits that's so big, and you're going to be the one that has to dig through it. If you look at the back of the book, you're going to go, there's the glossary, chloroplast. Oh, yeah, it's the cell part of a plant that turns sunlight and oxygen into sugar and carbon dioxide, or sunlight and carbon dioxide into sugar and oxygen. Cool. Got it. Done. Moving on. Index. If you are doing research in a book, which I'm very aware that most of you guys are going to do on the internet, there are definitely glossary and keyword resources on the internet, especially if you're using an internet-based textbook. There are definitely inserted media all over that. There are definitely table of contents in your internet resources, but frequently they're clickable. So you don't have to turn the page. You just go, click, I want to go to chapter one. It'll take you automatically. An index is something you're not going to find on the internet because you don't need it. The internet eliminated the need for indexes. But if you are using an actual book, which you will do in high schools and junior high science and social studies classes, the index is a listing of all the important vocabulary in the back of the book. So if you were doing research on teen stress and you wanted to know more about depression in teens because it was a point you're trying to make in the paper, you could flip to the index of the book, look for the word depression, and it would give you a list of every single page where they use the word depression. So if it's a 300-page book and they use the word depression on 10 pages, you don't have to scroll through the book. You just go directly to the index and say, they used it on page 10, 11, 12, 23, 24, 25. Those are the pages I'm going to look at. That cuts 290 pages out of what you need to look at. Make sense? This is a tool that is kind of like that little tool that I was talking about my mechanic having to look at the water pump. You don't need it until you need it. But when you need it, oh my gosh, it's going to save you hours. So the point here, you need a lot of tools because nonfiction is big. These tools are important because nonfiction is everything in the world that's actually true. You are doing a job when you are reading. When you do a job, you make the choice to use the tools correctly that will make the job the fastest and the most correct, right? Efficient. Yes, sir. Excellent vocabulary word. If you hire someone to do a job for you, you want them to be efficient, right? Think about it. If you are going to hire somebody to build something for you, Skylar, you're going to hire somebody to build a house for you. Do you want the person who's going to be efficient, fast, and good? Or do you want the person who'll get it done eventually?
Fast and good.
You want the person who's going to do it good. You want the person who's going to do it fast. You want the effective person. You don't want somebody up on your roof with a hammer and nails. You want the guy with the nail gun who's going to get it done in a day, not a hammer and nails that's going to get it done in 3 days. As long as he is being careful with that nail gun and not doing anything dumb and messing up your house, you're going to be happy, right? You are doing a job. You have the responsibility to know how to use these tools. And I want to clarify one more time, it comes to a surprise as a lot of students, it is not our expectation as teachers that you read the text over and over and over and over and over again. The next time I assign you a reading passage, I will have given you the tools to use so that you don't actually have to read it. If your goal is to answer the questions correctly, and my goal is for you to answer the questions correctly, I don't know whether or not you've read it. If you've used your tools correctly, looked up the answers, and gotten everything right, you get the same 100% A as the person who read it and then looked at the questions and then read it again and went through and found every question. But you just did a lot less work. If you like to read it, and it makes you feel more comfortable. I'm not going to tell you you're not allowed to. I will tell you it's not as efficient, but if it worries you and freaks you out and you have to read it all the way through, there's nothing wrong with that. You just got to be aware it's going to take you a little bit longer. It's fine as long as you're willing to put in the work. That's you making a judgment that you're better off using a hammer and nails because it makes you feel better. Does the same job get done? Yeah, totally. Good. All right.